Hello, welcome to this episode again. I'm Marieke de Witte. I'm a clinical psychologist, sexologist. I'm working at Maastricht University as an assistant professor, doing a lot of research on sexuality, also teaching on sexuality. And today we're going to talk about sex again and about having sex on your own. I have two guests. Maybe you can introduce yourself.
Hi, I'm Berghand. I'm 22 years old and I'm studying legal psychology here in Maastricht.
Okay.
I'm Bea, I'm 23, third year psychology student, and I'm super, super excited for this topic, the masturbation one.
Okay, well, welcome. As Bea said, we're going to talk about masturbation, and I think there's still a lot of taboos regarding masturbation, and I think now is the ideal time to break these taboos, to learn to masturbate better, and to understand what the benefits are of masturbation, because I think this taboo thing is still an issue. I don't know if you experience this in your personal life. Do you often talk about masturbation with friends?
Talking about benefits right away, I try to find articles to talk about today about like benefits of masturbation, such as on academical achievements or interpersonal relationships, but I found nothing.
Oh, interesting.
If there were article or research about it, then it was only about like personal well-being.
Yeah.
And even those were like the minority.
Yeah, it's indeed. We think about what are the functions of masturbation in terms of learning to know your own body and enhancing the relationship. But it's actually a good issue, a good point what you're raising here. Like, what are like the effects on broader outcome variables of masturbation?
Exactly.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, but maybe this is also reflecting the taboo there is still on masturbation, because maybe we don't do research about it because of the taboo. So, I mean, often we see that research on sexuality is also like guided by moral and moral judgment and things. So that could be a reason.
Yeah. I feel like there's a very big paradoxical approach to masturbation nowadays. Like, we know it happens, we know people do masturbate, but we don't dare to talk about it or like exchange information about it, you know? Like, for me, I think it should be a topic talked about normally, like the other ones,
because
you know?
It is a normal part of sexual development. I think it's really important to understand that masturbation is an important part of sexual development, because it's the only way to really learn to understand your own body, how it works and what you want, what you don't want. And it's also a very normal part, because we know that boys and girls start to masturbate at the start of puberty. Yeah. And there is still a difference that boys start to masturbate earlier, and that's part of, like, it's a part of play, you know? They have more experience with holding their penis already from young people already start to sort of hold their penis to pee, so they have more experience. And for girls, there's a higher threshold because they don't have external genitalia.
It's kind of giving this power, you know, like to the penis, this magic wand, you know? Like, and for example, to hit puberty, you have to like ejaculate, but then for girls, it's like having the period thing. You
yeah,
know?
Exactly.
And then to
have boys
sex.
Have the fun and girls have the misery. Yeah.
Exactly. This key lock analogy, you know, of like penetration is the only key to like full pleasure and everything.
Yeah, that's true. But I was also having a discussion with a friend about the like external and internal genitalia. And it's interesting because, for example, when women shower, they also like touch their vagina or like rub it. I don't know the specifics, but...
but it is. What we see is that actually girls explore their body during the showering. It's actually one of the places where you sort of touch yourself without feeling guilty, because you have to wash it. So,
So, but how come it only has an effect on men then, when they're touching it?
Because I think it's just also it's about also taboos that are already installed when you're younger. If you imagine, I mean, when you're a young child, I mean, they masturbate a lot. There's a peak in child masturbation between 3 and 6 years old. We always think that it starts at puberty, but actually young children already touch themselves. They kind of rub their penis against the wall, or they like write teddy bear and then they touch themselves. And when parents or other people just see young children touch themselves, they kind of install a rule like, no, they prohibit it. And they give negative messages, which actually installs a taboo. And it's good to to install social rules in the sense that, okay, it's nice to touch yourself, but don't do it in public, but never prohibit the behavior itself, because you give a very negative message. Because if you think about how we raise our children, often we learn them to give words. Eh? They name the things they see in the world. We also give words to their body parts. And it's like, oh, this is the ear, this is the eye, but we actually forget to name the part between the legs. So it has no name. You have to wipe it after peeing. It has to be clean. It's always dirty. I mean, it's like a lot of negative messages regarding these genitals.
Definitely.
And what we see is that these taboos are like even more pronounced in girls, because when boys touch their penis, it's like quite normal, just play it, and it's like, oh yeah, you know, it's so visible. But when little girls are touching their clitoris, then there's so much shame
attached to it. It's that, like, I shouldn't be doing this.
Yeah, that's also reflected in the conversations people have about it, because locker room talk, when boys have it, they talk about masturbation, or like it's mentioned, but I feel like girls don't really do that. It's like disgustingly connotated. Yeah. They're like, ew, I don't do that. What's that?
Yeah, and it starts, you know, so innocently, like really a normal behavior, human behavior. It starts, you know, like touching here and there, not even in a sexual way. When I first started discovering the orgasm kind of lifestyle, I was very young, and I remember it was this, like, just rubbing, actually.
Yeah,
like
but...
Pillows,
but
for
exactly,
example.
But exactly, but this is also what happens. I mean, when these young children between 3 and 6, I mean, when they are masturbating, it's just child exploratory sexual behavior.
Yeah.
And what it is, it's just, it gives you a pleasant feeling. And it's very normal that you repeat what is pleasant. So it has no sexual meaning at all. But we as adults look at it and we give it a sexual meaning. And then we freak out. It's not necessary, because it's just a pleasant feeling. So let them do, don't install these negative messages. And it gets a sexual meaning the moment the hormones kick in at puberty. And then it can sort of, then it becomes more goal-oriented, focused towards this orgasm and orgasmic release. But it's indeed, I mean, there are these taboos, and we see that boys talk about it much more. So it's not only about internal and external genitalia. That's why boys touch it more. It's also, there are more taboos. And I feel that women are still learn to inhibit their sexual expression. They still learn to sort of put the pleasure of the partner above their own pleasure, as long as he enjoys it.
That's true.
And it's being passive during sexuality.
Yeah.
We often see that it's more like, okay, give it to me and learn it to me. And that's a big issue. And it's like you say, I mean, it's very normal for boys to talk about masturbation and they do it, and everybody knows they do it, but it seems that girls don't do it. I don't know how you experience it and if this still is there, but...
Well, definitely, for example, there are certain people I can't talk about those topics, for example, family, like they would never accept, you know, such conversation, but I really try with my friends. For example, I'm extremely open about these talks, you know, sexuality and everything. They are less, but at the same time, I see that they engage in these conversations with me and are always like interested in learning more about it as well. And I just love that. I think like definitely discovering your body at a young age shouldn't be something you should be like ashamed of, you know, like you have to learn to know yourself also to better have boundaries as well.
Exactly.
You know, lack of boundaries, we see it every day, like with girls that, as you said, they don't know what they like, and they put their pleasure in the hands of their partner.
Yeah.
You know, as if the key, the penis, was the only way that they could attain pleasure.
But exactly, that's what they think, like most people think penetration is the key. I myself only like learned that really late, that most girls don't even come.
Yeah, obviously, but that's I mean, that's the biggest issue with orgasm, is that for a girl to reach orgasm, you need stimulation of the clitoris. Only the minority of women will reach orgasm via penetration. And it's just because it's our idea. We have this clitoris, and that's just that small node. It's just the top tip of the iceberg. It's like a large organ with a lot of nerves that is located deep into the vagina. So when you penetrate, you're actually stimulating this clitoral organ, the back of the clitoris. And what we know, it's partly genetically determined how much nerves you have. For some women, it's easier to reach orgasm during penetration, and for some, it's more difficult. Mm-hmm. But in any case, what we know is if you directly stimulate the clitoris, that's the best way to reach orgasm. But when you penetrate, I mean, then you just don't stimulate this clitoris. And so there is no difference between a clitoral and vaginal orgasm, to make it sure, because often we read that in magazines, and then it feels as if the vaginal orgasm is like the the top. I mean, that's like the aim, but it's not. I mean, it's always a clitoral orgasm. It's always stimulation of the clitoris. And I mean, you have to see that the clitoris is actually the same as the glands of the penis, because in the, I mean, when you in the embryonal stage, we see that the floor plan is female. We all start with a little knot, a clitoris, and then under the influence of testosterone, it grows into a penis. So this clitoris is actually a small penis. It also swells during sexual arousal, and it actually has much more nerves than the penis. So you need to stimulate that part to reach orgasm. And the problem is that because heterosexual couples are so much focused on penetration, they forget the clitoris. So, and then it's like, oh, I cannot orgasm. Yeah, because you don't get the right stimulation. If you want to orgasm during penetration, fine, but then use your fingers, use a small vibrator, use the fingers of your partner, but make sure that you get the stimulation that you need to reach orgasm.
But what I never understood then, just evolutionary speaking, how come it is outside then, if it's supposed to be penetrated? Also with the G point of the man, which is in the anus.
Yeah, the thing is that the vagina is actually the birth channel. It's not the lust channel. And that's the thing. I mean, it's a good thing that the vagina has not that much nerves, or it's not that much sensitive, because otherwise, I mean, that would be very painful during birth. So I think that's a little bit the thing, that it's external, because that's the pleasure, and the internal part, we often think, okay, why? But that's just for delivery, for birth. I mean, it's not for lust. It's not for sexual pleasure.
It's not like this tunnel where, in order to achieve like a sexual intercourse, it has to be penetrated. Like sometimes I feel like experiences are way more romantic and sensual when you're just with someone present there, some kisses, some touchy-touchy. Doesn't even have to be penetration, but that creates a very high climax and like a sexy experience.
But that's the evolutionary Catholic thing about sex, is about reproduction. And if you think about sex as reproduction, then you only need penetration. Why would you need pleasure? It's just ejaculating into the vagina so that you get fertilized. And I mean, that's the thing. So I think it's really, it comes back to this idea of sexual pleasure, because masturbation is about pleasing yourself. And it feels like that's the biggest issue. I mean, sex is for a long time was not about pleasure, or it was about pleasure of the men, but it was not about pleasure of girls or of women. And female sexual pleasure is still an issue, and that's why I think we still see these taboos regarding masturbation and sexual pleasure in women. And you can also see it in development, because boys and girls, they masturbate at a different rate and at a different timing. I mean, boys start to masturbate at 12 year, and it's part of playing. You know, they pee and they play, and they touch their genitals a lot, so eventually it comes down to sort of masturbating. And but for girls it's more difficult, and what we see is that they start to masturbate often after they had sex for the first time. So the problem is that when you're like, let's say, 16 years old, then this boy has already 4 years of experience with feeling how his body reacts, feeling what sexual arousal is, what orgasm is, but the girl doesn't know her body yet. So she again puts the responsibility for her sexual pleasure in the partner, like, okay, tell me what I need to do. And that's a big problem. They don't understand their body. And I think that's why masturbation is so important. It's the best way to discover what you need. It's about boundaries, what you said, knowing what you like and what you don't like, which touch you like and which not, and then communicate it to your partner. So it's actually all basically come down to understanding your own body.
Definitely. Yeah. And you said something very interesting, like about the genitals, you know, one developing inward and the other one outward, so the penis and vagina. And you know, I was thinking here in my head, as humans, like, we have this tendency to categorize, classify, like, and kind of assign meaning to things that kind of make sense that they have this meaning, if you know what I mean. And with penises and vaginas, I feel like because the penis is out there, it's in the public realm, like, we can discuss it normally. Like, when you see a hard penis, it's like, anyway, outside, so it's there, it's not hidden. But then the vagina goes inside, you know? No one sees when a girl is horny, actually. Like, no one knows what is happening there. It's just hidden. And I see this analogy that is so interesting, like, how I feel like society made sense of our organs and like how we should behave because of how things are biologically determined.
Exactly.
Somehow.
But it's also the names we give it. I don't know. I mean, in Dutch, you clearly hear it. You have the schaamlippen, the labia. We call it schaamlippen. So it's a labia. I mean, that's already the naming and the schaamhaar. I mean, it's also about shame. It's really about shame labia. So it's the shame part of our body. I mean, why do we give these names? It's not something to be ashamed of.
Not at all.
I mean, so if we look at the names we give to the female genitals, it's about shame. And then the male genitals are more like the sort of straightforward naming.
Also about what you said, I the same conversation I had, as I mentioned earlier, with my friend. Yesterday, we were talking about this external genitalia thing, and then to me, it made total sense that because a guy has something dingling down there, like he's more prone to touch it. It just made sense. But she was like, no, like, why does it make sense? And I couldn't explain it. And then I was like, wait, maybe it is socially, maybe I just am supposed to think it makes sense.
Mm-hmm.
So it is true. It has a huge effect on like how you view it.
Yeah. But it is. It cannot only be anatomically determined because you have external, internal, and okay, that's why you touch it more. You can understand why it's easier that there's a higher threshold for girls to start touching. But at the same time, it's mainly also about the messages you get and about the fact that it's so normal to talk about masturbation in boys, and it's like very much more restricted in girls. And that's what we still see. I mean, that a lot of girls have a lot of difficulties to watch themselves, to touch themselves. They feel as if it's a sin, as if it's a sort of masturbation, it's denying your partner something. And I do see that it's also in boys. I think it's also that masturbation still has some negative connotation, as if it is something that if you masturbate, especially when you're in a relationship, then there's something wrong. Then it's
I was going to ask, do you consider that, you know, like masturbating when you're in a relationship would be considered cheating? Because some people say that.
Yeah, exactly. It's the same with watching porn, but we will talk about it in another episode. But it seems like sex, you can only have that with your partner. And it's like when you're in a relationship solo sex and partner sex are two different types of sex, and they serve different functions. So they can exist side by side. It's no problem. I mean,
But also because it's so open with men, they are put in a more active role all the time, and women are always passively perceived during sex, which makes it more problematic if the guy, for example, can't get an erection. Then women will usually think, oh my gosh, like, am I not like sexy enough? Like, what's the problem?
And the man attributed to themselves and the relationship.
The man will think, what's wrong with me? What's wrong with my body? Why can't I perform? It's because you're not a machine. Like, you're not supposed to perform all the time.
Yeah, exactly.
It's a huge
And that's the
problem.
Interesting thing is that we, like, even I tend to, like, put so much like weight on, oh, it's the men's fault, the way they created this world. Like, us women, we feel like incapable. We feel like undervalued because of this. But we don't talk that often about the feelings of shame and low self-esteem that men experience also in those situations. Yeah. I saw a shift in like my sexual life, like before when I was younger and doing it with younger people also, like teenage sex kind of years. They didn't really talk about, you know, the feminine pleasure, you know, it was just like penetration, that's it. As I was growing up, experimenting a little bit more here and there, I see that men now, they have this also like uncomfortable feeling when the girl doesn't come, and then they try for hours of like so long time, you know, like to make you come, and they don't understand that sometimes the whole experience is important.
It's because the orgasm is put in such a focus, as you said earlier, maybe even the like religious view has an effect, because the whole point of sex is coming, which is not true. It's about like
But it is. I mean, it is. There is still this reward. I mean, it has an enormous rewarding experience to climax. Eh? And I think it's true that, I mean, sex is not all about orgasm. The thing is that what you often read is that, orgasm is not important for women. You know, it's like, but that's not true. I mean, as a woman, I mean, of course, it's more than orgasm, but you want to climax once in a while. It's not only about the intimacy and about the relationship. It's just sometimes just physical gratification. So it has a very much rewarding value, but it doesn't mean that it needs to be goal-oriented, that sex needs to aim for, and that you only have had sex when you reach orgasm.
Yeah.
I think that's important. We still have this idea that sex is penetration and then orgasm. And so when these ingredients are not part of it, you didn't have sex.
Like, there's a hyper-focus on the orgasm. It's not the way anymore, it's only the the end point.
Yeah.
Also when people masturbate, like most people don't masturbate just, you know, to have like a chill short time and then like get gone with their lives. Yeah. Like they really want to like come at them.
I think it's important to sort of understand that masturbation can be experienced in a broader way. It does not need to be goal-oriented towards climaxing. It can also be about touching yourself, exploring your body. You don't need to, but it is also, it depends on why you masturbate. Sometimes, and a lot of people masturbate just to release tension, to release stress. And what we see is during exam periods or testing periods, we see that a lot of, especially boys, are masturbating because it's a relief of a release of distress. So when it's like that, then this orgasm is important because you really need this also physical release. But I mean, orgasm can also be, masturbation can also be about, touching yourself, spoiling yourself, just taking time for yourself, self-care, body care, and then it gets a different meaning. So if it's really about exploring your own body, then you don't need to reach orgasm. Then it's really about, okay, which parts in my body or which stimulation do I like? What is pleasant to do? And it just really depends on which aim you're masturbating.
I see that, you know, the sexual well-being that one has really goes up to like the overall mental well-being, basically. Like once I start being more in touch with my body, and like even my friends, when they start being comfortable with this thing of like masturbating and everything, the amount of love that you have for your body, like, you know yourself, and like, hey girl, touching here and there, like, do you like this? Like, yes, I like this. Feels just so good.
Yeah, and it is important because we do know that a lot of sexual problems are the result of not getting the right stimulation. That's a big issue. Yeah. I mean, if you have pain during sex, difficulties to reach orgasm, it's not something in your body or physical. It's often like just not getting the right stimulation. So you need to explore yourself. And that's so important because if we think about sexual arousal, there are two parts. There's on the one hand your bodily arousal, mm-hmm. and then there's your mental, subjective arousal. And what we know is that when there's a sexual stimulus, your body reacts automatically within seconds without even thinking about sex. It's just an automatic reaction. And then when it will develop in a full-blown sexual response depends on how you evaluate the sexual stimulus. So this evaluation of the sexual stimulus is really important to really experience this desire to do something with sex. And the problem is that when you expect something bad to happen or when you do not expect a reward, then you do not desire it. Yeah. I mean, when you had negative experiences, when it's you experience pain during sex, or when you don't get the right stimulation, when you always, you know, okay, we always penetrate and you don't like it, then probably you will have more difficulties to get aroused because it's not rewarding. So that's why it's so important to just explore your body to understand what is rewarding for me, to make sure that's part of your sexual script.
Exactly.
And also realize that what was rewarding before is not always rewarding now. It may be in the first years of your relationship, you get excited by this stimulation, but maybe after 10 years, it doesn't work anymore. So the self-exploration is not something, okay, when you're young, you explore yourself and then you're in a relationship, you know your body and then it stops.
Yeah.
No, it's a continuous process. It's never finished. I mean, the sexual stimulation and these needs for sexual stimuli can change throughout your life. So this masturbation is just an important part in every part, not only during sexual development and adolescence, but also later on in your relationship.
Yeah, that's true.
About exploring yourself, but also just simply spoiling yourself. I mean, it has different functions and that's important.
But I think it also has again to do with like insecurities and shame in that way. Because if you, let's say you're in a relationship of 10 years and after 5 years, you just don't enjoy the sex the way you did before, then most people don't want to communicate that to their partner because they don't want to give them the feeling of not being satisfied anymore.
Yeah, exactly. That's an issue. It's the lack of communication. I always say that sex is about stimulus, context, and communication. You have to get the right stimulus.
Yeah.
Then you have to communicate it to your partner, and the context needs to be safe and okay, and you feel appreciated by your partner. And these three ingredients are so important. So this part of, okay, exploring your body, knowing what you need, but then communicating it to your partner. That's very important. Yeah. Because, I mean, if your partner is giving you a certain stimulation and you don't like it, I mean, you discovered, hey, I like other parts of my body touched, or I want sort of my clitoris to be touched in a different way, then you need to communicate that to your partner.
Definitely.
Because, I mean, you know it for yourself, but also your partner needs to know
And staying silent just makes it that next time you'll probably try the same thing again, thinking that he's giving you some pleasure because, you know, like, you pretend that you were having pleasure in that.
Exactly.
Yeah, that's the biggest problem.
Yeah. Yeah.
You have that in one night stands, like when they do something in the beginning and you don't say something and they keep doing it.
Yeah, it's about communicating, and that's really important. And just knowing your body, exploring your body, and that's why masturbation is so important. And we do see that, especially for women. I mean, it seems, I feel that masturbation in men is more like, there can also be a lot of shame and this idea of sin, and it often has also some religious background. But at the same time, in women, it seems like even stronger. I mean, this shame seems even deeper ingrained in our society. And I think for a lot of girls, it's difficult to touch themselves. And then you can sort of take different steps. And I think sometimes when I meet women who are really, really much reserved and ashamed about their body, that it can just start simply by taking a shower and experience yourself and just touch yourself, wash yourself, not like in five minutes, but take the time to slowly touch the different parts and experience like, hey, when I touch my arm, it feels different than when I touch my neck or when I touch my thigh. It just explore the different parts, different sensations, just that. Or maybe after showering, just take a body lotion and explore your body. I mean, that's the first step. And then it's also about self-love and self-care. I mean, go stand in front of the mirror, watch yourself, and name five things that you like about yourself. Because we're always so much focused on, oh, my nose and this and this and this, and all very critical. Yeah. But just try to focus on the positive part, because this self-love is important. Mm. Do it a few times a week or maybe even daily, just to sort of get to acquainted with your body.
Yeah, that is also really important, because it raises your trait gratitude. I just read a study about it the other day, that the more trait gratitude you have, hence like the more thankful you are, the less dissatisfied you are with your life.
Yeah.
So it's really important to do these kind of exercises to basically like maybe even prevent depression.
Exactly.
Or like the likelihood of it.
Exactly.
I think so that also really helps. Like helps a lot. Like a technique that is like I've done, and some of my girls have done too. Might sound extreme at first, but it's just like basically spreading your legs in front of a mirror and get to know your vagina. Exactly. You know, look at it. Touch a little bit, try to find that one spot where you have a little bit of pleasure. Look inside, you know.
Yeah.
We tend to think like our vaginas are weird because maybe the labia are too out there, or maybe they're not at all out there, or our clit
which
is bigger.
Okay. There's no normal vulva.
We think
different.
Like it's so different, but it's so same, but different.
Yeah,
so
it is. And I think it's really important what you're saying. Just lying on the bed, taking a hand mirror and just watch yourself.
Yes.
So many women don't know how their vulva, they know the pictures on the screen, but they don't know how their own vulva looks like.
Mm.
And it's so important to just watch it and be aware of this, the labia, that they look differently. And we have a lot of labiaplasty and cosmetic surgery nowadays going on because people feel insecure about their labia because often they are like seeing the porno movies and all these pictures which are photoshopped, or they already had this surgery. So I mean, we have this ideal of the prepubescent vulva.
It's
pink, it's pale, and it's like very strict, and the labia are like squeezed inside. That's not how a normal or vulvas look like. I think that's really important. And I think it's really important to just lie on the bed, watch it, and then touch yourself, and then experiment, sort of touch with touching your clitoris and vulva, and different paces, different tempo, and a little bit faster, slower, harder, softer. Maybe use some glue or use sort of your saliva to make it and maybe use a small vibrator, which is also very much important, because if you use a vibrator, it gives you a maximum stimulation, and it will become easier to reach orgasm. And the moment you learn to recognize these signals of orgasm, it will make it easier to reach orgasm during sex with a partner.
Definitely. That's so important what you just said.
Yeah, you need to understand it. And often it's the first time you say, what was it? Was it? So you try it again, and then you start to understand your body, understand how it reacts.
Yeah.
And that's what you need, because then when you have sex with a partner, you just know these signals.
It's like, this stimuli that you notice, like I realize that sometimes I see the stimuli that makes me think of like these this very pleasurable instance. I hold on to that stimuli, and it's a chain of events, basically.
Exactly.
Yeah, that's true.
Exactly. And that's what you need to recognize. That's what that's why masturbation is so important. It's often, I mean, when you're having sex with your partner, so you're so much focused also on the partner, and then you lose that grip. So you need sort of to have this masturbation, because then you know I only need to be concerned with myself, with my own body, what I experience. Then you can sort of let go and you understand your body, and then you can sort of apply it during sex with a partner. I think that's very important, just this part of understanding and knowing, because we know from research that women who masturbate, they enjoy sex with a partner more and reach orgasm easier, just because they just know what stimulation they need, and they have more experience with orgasm.
That's what I was gonna say. Like, I feel like once someone gives themselves to this masturbatory kind of lifestyle, you know, like being open with that and everything, guys, you don't understand the amount of power that it will bring to your lives. Not about control. It's not you being in control of your life or everything. It's just you being in touch with your persona, you being in touch with your feminine, sexual, masculine power or whatever. And it just feels so empowering. And as
it's empowerment.
The sexual relationships afterwards, like, they're much better because you're not going to lie to yourself for, like, 1 hour. You're there and you're just,
and you just explore and then you can apply it. So we were talking about orgasm, and as we already said, I mean, masturbation is not only about reaching orgasm. Again, it's also, I mean, there are very much different ways to explore yourself. You can also just explore yourself using your body and also stimulating your mind. It's not only about stimulating your body, but using fantasy, which is also so important. I mean, when you masturbate, I mean, you can watch porn, which is also a trigger of sexual arousal, but you can also just fantasize. And it's kind of the vibrator of your mind, and you don't have to feel guilty about the content of your fantasies, because you're the director of your own film. It's just a fantasy. You're not acting out on it. And we know that that people are fantasizing about other partners and about having sex in fancy spaces. I mean, that's normal. That's okay. Even during sex with your partner, fantasizing about somebody else is okay.
But the question is, where do we draw the line? We're fantasizing. Mm-hmm. Like, is it ever considered cheating? Or even, like, worst cases, for example, I know a case where some man was fantasizing about, like, eating someone else while having sex.
Yeah, or like, and then children, fantasizing about children, exactly, you know?
But then, for example, in that case, he didn't do it, but he noted it down and the police found the notes, and then he got arrested in the end.
Really? Because I don't follow that line of reasoning, because in my mind, I mean, fantasy is fantasy. As long as you don't act...
But the question is, how do you know they won't act? Because it's sexual. Yeah, but
that's the issue, like with pedophilia. I mean, you have pedophilic desire, and then you have pedophilic behavior, and I think that's really a difference. Because
it breaks my heart, these people, because, like, most of them actually don't even act on it.
Yeah, exactly.
It has nothing to do with them being mean or anything, to want and to desire sexual relationships with children. There's, like, even these two hypotheses: one more related to sadism, the other one more related to just how the brain developed. You know, like, at one point in life, they just didn't develop the way adult brains develop, and so they feel way more attracted and attached to younger people. And
exactly,
I have so much empathy.
It's the object of desire, and I think, of course, we need to screen, and it is important that you look for risk factors, and is there any moral judgment, is there impulsive behavior. There are some red flags when people have these paraphilic desires that you think, okay, should we do something with it? But as long as it is a desire and it's just a fantasy, it's okay. Because, I mean, we all know it, that you walk around on a bridge and then you fantasize about throwing somebody off. I mean, that's something you never would act on it. It's just something. It's an intrusive thought. Yeah. That's something.
But how do you know someone will act on it?
That's a whole other discussion. Yeah. I mean, we do have a lot of screening instruments and to look at dynamic and static risk factors for paraphilic disorders.
And that's
disorders.
The thing. I feel like fantasy, like what I heard, is that this idea of fantasies is something that you're not allowed to do actually in your everyday life, you know? Yeah. So it's kind of like this, the forbidden, you know, that everyone is attracted to the forbidden.
Exactly. And that's just also during sex. I mean, it's also about something special. You just use it to spice up the sexual act. And so it's actually quite normal just to fantasize and just use it, use your fantasy, use your imagination to spice it up. Because especially also when having sex with a partner, I mean, you during the arousal and desire, you're focusing on your partner, but the moment you want to reach orgasm, you need to let go of your partner. And that's the part often when people just go into their mind, start to fantasize, focus on their own thoughts, because it's just a way to just pass that threshold and to reach this orgasm. It's like this
to transcend, basically. Also, I feel like we're like these free beings, you know, and then we have all these norms, and that's exactly what creates the shame also, and like all this stigma, you know.
Shame is a huge problem though during fantasy, during sex, because I'll be honest, like sometimes when I have sex, I do think about like other people or like having sex with other people, and then I start blaming myself, and then it becomes like a chain of shit, like, what am I doing? I shouldn't.
But that's why. Then,
I mean, that's why it's so important to just allow yourself to fantasize and do not, because then you're installing a rule and a prohibition and a taboo again. So just I mean, don't feel guilty and just fantasize and just use it, as I said, as a vibrator of your mind. It's just an extra stimulant. And I think it's really important, because if we think about all these thoughts we have during sex, I mean, also when you are exploring yourself during this masturbation or when having sex with a partner, learn to relax and learn to maintain your attention to what, to your senses, what you feel and what you see and what you smell, because it's so important. Don't engage into spectatoring. We call it spectatoring because it's like, hey, what am I doing here? How am I lying here? Yeah. Oh, I have a little bit fat. What will he think of me? So we have all these intrusive thoughts in a meta perspective while we are exploring ourselves or during sex with a partner, which you lose your sexual arousal. So don't get distracted by these thoughts, and just, if they are there, accept them, bring your attention back to your body, and just learn to relax, learn to focus, maintain your attention to yourself. It's so important, because we have all these different thoughts and all these taboos on sexuality. We feel guilty about the fantasies. We feel guilty about masturbation. I mean, there's so much guilt going on.
Yeah, I love that you use the sentence exploring oneself, because actually, like, from the Latin masturbare, it has these two words, manus and then stuprum or something like that, and basically means hands plus creating chaos within oneself, you know? So it's kind of like using your hands, like your touch or whatever, to create this state of like chaos. And everyone knows in chaos there is stillness, you know? So it shows its importance again, you know?
That's true. But talking about guilt during masturbation, regarding something Bea said earlier with the cheating, because I know some people who consider like masturbation during a relationship as cheating, or like blame themselves as not being enough. And I think it's a topic we should address too. Mm-hmm. And like, what do you tell such a person? Because it obviously is normal. Like, we all just want to be for ourselves and explore ourselves once in a while. But how do you make it clear to someone?
I think what is most important is just to understand that it's two different parts of sex. And that's how I always explain it to people. Don't feel guilty. It's not, I mean, you can use masturbation and solo sex. It's handy because it's a way, I mean, especially nowadays with COVID, when your partner is not around, it's actually very good to masturbate. And then also when your partner has less desire, imagine there's a discrepancy in desire. One partner has more desire than the other one. We have the idea that, okay, the one with the low desire needs to come up to the level of the high desire partner. No, it's finding a compromise. So if you have more desire than your partner, then use masturbation to deal with the discrepancy, or just to supplement your partner sex, because you can use the solo sex to explore yourself, to understand your body better, but you can, and that can help you in partner sex. So it can make the partner sex better. So you can focus just simply in spoiling yourself, pleasing yourself, but it's also a vehicle to sort of make partner sex better. So it's, that's how you should see it. It's just something completely different. It's not that you deny your partner something, that you, that it's a sign that something is going wrong in your relationship, that it's cheating, that it's a sin, whatever. It's just something different. It's a different experience. It's something you do for yourself, but you can also use it in your partner relationship. I think that's the best way to explain it, that it is not cheating. It's just one component of our sexuality, and that's so important. And also, well, what I do think is also very much important, because we are talking now about masturbation and how important it is, and that it can help you to understand yourself and the partner relationship. But to be sure, it's not a must. We should not create new norms, especially also when we are talking about, hey, you can use a vibrator and explore yourself and so on. You don't need to. As long as you want it and you find it's pleasant, it can be handy, it can help yourself, especially I think here in this COVID situation. It's just a good way. And I think this is the ideal period actually to learn to masturbate better. There's less time to invest with a partner, so maybe just use this period to understand your body better, to spoil yourself, because there's so much negative information, so much negative going on. So that's like a pleasant feeling, something you do for yourself. Self-care is so important nowadays, so just use it as a way of self-care, as a way of exploring yourself. And then when finally this lockdown will be over, you can use all the skills you learned when having sex with a partner.
No, it's beautiful that you say that, because it's true. Like, everyone goes through this journey or path, like, at their own rhythm, their own ways, and there's no correct way of achieving orgasm. There's no correct way to touch yourself, to love yourself, to do anything. There's no correct way, basically. So do you. And
do you. And I think it's important, just if you feel that it's shame and guilt that is blocking you, try to work on that with these different steps, like going in a shower and just build it step by step, and just try to overcome these guilt feelings. But if it's more than, if it's not guilt, if it's just like, I don't feel like it, and it's okay. I mean, it's just, you can try it out, explore it. If it's not something for you, then you just don't do it. But so I think it's just a good way to
explore. Went through these phases in my life where I thought, I'm completely asexual, because for like 2 years, I was not interested at all in those things, not even masturbating. Then all of a sudden, like super interested. So yeah, it's always changing. Yeah, like our life goes through phases like that.
Yeah, it's that there's no normal when it comes to sexuality. I mean, it's not, I mean, I do believe that girls should sort of start to explore their body earlier and sort of over, because I think there are a lot of thresholds and guilds. But when you do not, I mean, you can also explore your body when you're 25, when you're 30, when you're 40. And as I said, it's a continuous process. It's never ending. It's never finished. Just please do it and just sort of explore it. At least try it and see what it does. And if you don't feel like it, well, that's okay.
I think it's about what you said, like realizing what's stopping me. Is it social pressure? Is it guilt? Is it like me actually not wanting to? Because girls also are like entering or starting puberty earlier than men. So it actually makes sense that they would even like start masturbating earlier.
Yeah, that's exactly. But it's just also the messages we give. And I think it's like I said in the beginning of the podcast, it's also about, it already starts when you're a child and talking with your parents about sex. And I mean, young children ask so many questions about sexuality. I mean, they do exploratory behavior, they play doctor, they masturbate, but they also ask questions, like, because they want to know how, oh, you're a girl, you're a boy, and you have a penis, and I don't have that. What is it? And where do children come from? They just want to explore their world as if they want to know, what is this cow doing there? And I mean, it's just a normal question. And we as adults get, we freak out because, oh, it's a question about sex and they're too young. No, they're not too young. They're just are curious. Just give an answer. Talk with your children about sex, because you will see that when you have this habit of talking about sex, then your child knows this is a normal topic. Whenever I have questions about sexuality, I can talk about it with my parents. You install this very more open atmosphere, and that is so important, because sometimes parents think, okay, when they're 12, we're going to start talking about sex because it's a puberty. But like for 12 years, you never talked with your parents about sex, and then suddenly then it's awkward. You don't want to talk to them.
And it also creates this kind of feeling that, oh, this is something so special, so out there, like the ultimate form of like something. When makes part of our everyday life, and like as you said, the stigma, like this putting stigma in someone's way of thinking, starts super early.
It starts early, and it's not blaming the parents, it's a larger societal thing that we always have this idea, oh, sex is something special, and everyone starts to giggle. Let's just start to talk
the
about
giggle
sex
thing.
It's just really a normal part of life, and I think it's just, and I think this is also one of the aims of this podcast, is to give you information, give you words, give you a language to learn to talk about sexuality, because it will help you throughout life. And creating this openness, I think that's one of the things we want to achieve here. It's like addressing these different topics, creating openness, and just understanding that sex is just a part of life. So let's just act normal about it. Thank you. Thank you again for being here and for this interesting conversation. Thank you again for listening. And I hope you you join us again for the next episode. Thank you.
See you.